So we've invited three individuals to just talk about their research and talk about what they're doing right now. And we're going to start with one of Hillary's colleagues, Friederike Schur, who's going to come out and tell us what exactly they're doing under the hood at Fast Forward Lab. So I'll give the stage to you.
Thank you. We had some technical difficulties earlier, so I'm just crossing my fingers that now everything will work. Big thanks to Amy and the staff at Bloomberg who sort of actually organizing this all, putting it together and helped me this morning to sort of, there we go, get my presentation up on the screen. I'm Friederike Schur and I work for Fast Forward Labs. You just saw Hillary Mason, the founder of Fast Forward Labs here as part of the panel. We are an applied machine learning research and advising company. At Fast Forward, we do technical deep dives into emerging technologies that we believe will find widespread adoption within industry within the next 6 months to 2 years. And we chose that time frame because while it's ambitious, it also keeps us grounded in reality. It sort of means that actually we're taking the applied part of machine learning seriously, where we're trying to use emerging and new capabilities in order to solve real-world problems. Or as I like to say, we like to think about sci-fi and then keep it real. We write research reports and we build fully functioning prototypes to showcase those emerging capabilities that are enabled by new machine learning algorithms and data science techniques. And in addition, we work with clients from small startups to large enterprise on how to best leverage the power of data science and machine learning within their organization. Because in the end, new tools are only useful if you actually put them to good use. So check us out. One of the first capabilities we explored, and Hillary briefly mentioned that, was natural language generation. Here you actually see sort of someone speed reading our report. Our research reports that provide an introduction to the topic, why it's worth your time and hopefully also worth your money, and that they also provide a how-to guide for technical teams in order to implement some of these emerging capabilities to really grow in-house solutions. We also include two chapters that I personally really like. One is sort of a sci-fi story, like what would the world look like if these sort of capabilities become widespread? And I think that's really important to sort of like motivate ourselves to really think big, because it's really exciting how the world is changing around us. Of course, once you have impact, there's sort of the flip side. You can have impact in a way that you didn't intend to, and that is why we always include a chapter on ethics to get the conversation started, as Hillary mentioned. Natural language generation, the topic of our first report, it basically takes structured data and it turns it into human-readable text. Basically, computers are learning to speak our language. To showcase this capability, we built a prototype to generate real estate listings. It's called RoboRealtor. So let's say I'm a real estate agent and I just got a new listing. In this case, a two-bedroom, one-bathroom on the Lower East Side with laundry in the building. It's not too bad. What RoboRealtor does, basically, it takes that structured input and then it generates real estate listings that in language actually match the kind of language that a human being, a human real estate agent would use if they were to write a real estate listing for that particular area. Because you can imagine, the Upper West Side, the kind of language that's used there, is quite different from the one that you would use on the Lower East Side. And if you want to get that right, you sort of have to pick up on those sort of subtleties and then also integrate that into the text that you are suggesting. If I'm not a real estate agent, I can pick one, I can modify it a little bit if I don't like exactly how it came out, and then I'm done. And that's a lot faster and a lot easier than actually writing one from scratch. So that is sort of one of the powers of NLG. Associated Press now uses robot journalists to report on baseball games, robot journalists write weather reports. NLG is also used to generate tailored reports to explain the performance of individual stock portfolios. So lots of uses. Will AI soon win Pulitzer Prize? Interesting question. A group of artists and machine learning researchers trained a recurrent neural network on movie scripts to teach the network how to write its own script. And the result, Sunspring, it's truly mesmerizing, but I believe it mainly showcases the power of the human mind to make sense of nearly everything. What's actually funny, like the researchers asked their own neural network, what is the future of machine-written entertainment? And here's the answer from the neural net. It's a bit sudden. I was thinking of the spirit of the men who found me and the children who were all manipulated and full of children. I was worried about my command. I was the scientist of the Holy Ghost. I mean, I think it does truly sort of show that there's a certain poetry to it, isn't there? And I sort of find it fascinating, and I really encourage you to check out and watch that whole movie. It's really fun. But it also shows what's challenging about applied machine learning, especially when you want to put it in front of a customer. For one of our next reports, we used actually the same technique that powered Sunspring, that wrote that movie script, but we used it in order to, in a sense, solve the reverse problem of natural language generation. That is, if you have a long piece of text, how can you very quickly extract just the gist of it so that you don't actually have to spend a lot of time sort of going through it and trying to understand what's actually in that particular sort of article? And that's particularly useful for busy people in this very information-rich world. We built a prototype called Brief, that auto-summarizes articles for you. So basically you're reading like The Atlantic or The New York Times and you find something that's really cool, but also you have to get to work, so you can't actually spend 50 minutes reading it. You take the URL, you put it into our prototype called Brief, and then it will extract for you the 5 most representative sentences of that particular article. And that is what you see here on the site, and then if you want to see those sentences in context, you can actually scroll through the article here, and that can sort of help you disambiguate if the individual sentence doesn't quite make sense on its own, and that really reduces the time that you would have to spend in order to read and understand that article. And so now that is used, for example, by discretionary traders who have to, like, digest a lot of information as they sort of think and ponder the next trade, and this sort of basically enables them to do reading at scale, something that when we were in college, I'm sure we all wish we could have done. Our most recent report was on probabilistic programming, which is a set of techniques to make Bayesian inference more accessible. And this is a little bit outside of text, but I come to it in a second. We built a prototype to help people buy real estate in New York City. So say I had $1.5 million. Where could I buy property? How about where I actually currently live? Bushwick. So in 2015, this shows Bushwick, if it's a darker color, it means there are more properties available for me given my budget. 2015, it actually would have been possible for me to buy property in Bushwick. Most properties there had a sales price that was actually below my sort of budget. 2017, it goes really quickly in New York, which is somewhat terrifying, right? And I'm sort of regretting my own past decisions. Why were we actually interested in probabilistic programming? Because these techniques that we used for summarization, for example, recurrent neural networks, they're somewhat hard to understand. They're somewhat black boxy. It's very difficult to understand why the techniques makes a particular prediction. And that, if we sort of go back to a theme that was part of the earlier panel, like the sort of machine-human cooperation, well, if the algorithm doesn't really allow us to look at it and understand what it's doing and why it's doing what it's doing, well, then that cooperation is really hard. And so probabilistic programming and Bayesian inference, it's a so-called white box technique. It's a lot easier to understand why it sort of makes these predictions. And that also allows us to learn something about the world, namely here, how quickly sort of real estate prices change and also why. If you have sort of any questions about some of the techniques, this is a very short presentation that are behind it, come find me during the break, and I'm very happy to talk about some of the technology that is actually behind it. On a final note, I sort of talked about, we have an applied machine learning research and advising company. Quickly, the advising. I talked about a bunch of prototypes that really showcase new capabilities, often that come straight out of machine learning research. And that's really great, but it means that basically we, as sort of data scientists, machine learning engineers, the toolbox that we have in order to solve problems continuously grows. And that's really exciting, but it is also a challenge because those tools are new and it's sometimes hard to understand how to best apply them. And so what I've seen in the past is sometimes, a little analogy here, people go and what they need to do is they cut a piece of string and they go at it with a chainsaw, or they have a bunch of trees and they try scissors. And that happens when you don't quite yet know and understand the tools that we have. And that is only natural in this world, but tools are so novel. But that is where the advising part of Fast Forward comes in, to help identify opportunities, help identify which tools are actually really suitable to solve real and applied problems. Thank you very much.
Friederike will join us again on stage you can sit now if you'd like and enjoy Shifu's presentation. Shifu Cheng is going to join us now. Shifu is a senior vice dean at Columbia, and he is really, if you read any academic paper about computer vision, or many of the technologies we'll discuss today, you will note Shifu's name in the citations if the paper wasn't written by him. And so it's exciting to have him here. I've had the privilege of working with a couple of teams that have come out of his lab to try to help them commercialize their technology. I'm excited to hear what he'll present today. So, Shifu.
Okay, good morning. Thank you for the very nice word, Justin. And a lot of work is with collaborators and students. Actually, one of my students is going to present his startup company later this afternoon. So I'm going to make a link to his talk also. So I'm Shifu Chen, looking at digital video multimedia work. Columbia has been there for more than 20 years, working with Kathy McKeon on a lot of joint projects also. Wonderful to be here. So what I'm going to share with you today in a few minutes is to see, really report what is going on in computer vision multimedia area. And people talk about AI is revolutionizing this field, and it's making a lot of impact in understanding the content, searching the content, not only in text, which wonderfully discussed earlier, but also in the multimedia, including image, video, and 3D. And so these are the three actually quotes from old news. Actually, if you look at the recent news, a lot of actually report on what is the advances in AI, advancing the capability of a machine to understand images, faces, and even using the visual content to search, to find the product, or maybe to make the transaction. So some of the example you probably recognize, the Google Goggle in the past, actually you can actually take a pictures from a Goggle, you can recognize what's the object or building in front of you, and overlay certain information about a landmark. So it's a very well-known concept. One of my colleagues at Columbia, Peter Bill-Humer, has developed a very nice system. And if you're wondering in the Central Park, wondering what is the plants or the flower in the tree or in the park, and then you can take a picture of the leaf, and then that will recognize what kind of plants or flower that you are seeing. Recently, he and his student is looking at pet snap or dog snap. So if you're walking on the sidewalk and wondering what kind of wonderful breed of a dog is coming to you, take a picture of the dog, and then you can understand what is the related lovely attributes of the dog. My group is looking at the similar problem on the visual search. If I take a picture of a 3D object, and the 3D object may not be in the perfect lighting condition, can you extract useful information and then send that one to the cloud to recognize the object or maybe the product you're interested in buying? And a lot of a challenging issue here is, how do you minimize the power consumption? How do you minimize the amount of bandwidth you need to transmit over a wireless network? And how do you get the result from millions or billions of a product to find the product you want to explore in real time? So this was actually a prototype we built in 2012. The student was, for the first time, implement this kind of so-called hash-based visual product search. Take a picture of the shoe he was wearing and then crop the object in not a perfect lighting condition and quickly, and he was so excited in 2012. You can see the excitement there. A shoe on the floor, again, not in the perfect lighting condition, 3D angle, different size, different scale, and you can quickly find. So the challenge, so we can turn to the next slide here. So the challenge is really, how do you do that in your hand quickly, reliably, without burning all the power and the bandwidth that you have to pay for? And there's a lot of research going on here. Recently, another student in my group actually went through the combined program that Justin and Satish organized, is to take this visual recognition capability to the next stage, that if you see certain style product, no matter is dress or bag or scarf or jewelry, can the machine help you to recognize the style attributes? So not only matching the appearance, but actually trying to recognize the style attributes. So the design of the neckline, the design of the sleeve, the pattern, the color pattern, the object shown on the surface, and then use that to find the product that potentially could be suited to the needs of the user. And the user can also interact with the interface to specify different attributes. The next step people are working on, including our group, is extending it to 3D VR, AR. So you can snap a picture of an object, you can find information about that, but can I manipulate with that object in a 3D fashion? So assuming that you have all the 3D model in the cloud has been designed or stored, can I take a picture using the depth camera or stereo camera and quickly do the machine and AI to do the matching over, as I say earlier, wireless network and a large cloud database, find the 3D model that potentially suits your need, and then you can overlay the 3D model on top of a real-world environment to manipulate and then maybe engage in certain AR and VR application. Coming back to maybe this one link to the previous session also nicely, can machine describe what's in the scene? Not only matching, can we find the appropriate annotation or label for that scene? And there was a very famous competition in the last 6 or 7 years in computer vision called ImageNet Large Scale Visual Recognition, and was attended by hundreds of groups around the world. The challenge was the following. Given a picture, can machine generate 5 keywords describe it? As long as any keyword is correct, it's treated correctly. So if it's all the 5 keywords are incorrect, then it failed. Out of over the last 6 or 7 years, over the test data of 100,000 images, the machine was able to improve the recognition error rate from 28% down to 3%. And this is a localization, not only describing what's in the picture, but also localizing and draw the bounding box, see what's in the pictures. Now the next step is video. If you can locate and recognize the object, can you locate a small snippet in the video that could be hours long, and there's a very exciting cricket bowling event, can the machine detect it and recognize it? And not only say, okay, there's a cricket bowling there, you also have to be precisely detect the beginning and ending. And this is very important for advertising, for video editing and production. So there's a lot of work, including my group, a recent paper coming out in CBPR 17. The state of art currently is still at 40% accuracy. So out of all the detected results of the event, 40% accurate, so still 60% is still wrong. Not only object and event, can the machine recognize the relationship? So you have 3 objects there, the elephant, 2 person there. What's the relationship? The person riding the elephant, another person walking behind the elephant, and one is taller than the other. So there's a lot of competition also trying to advance the state of art performance in this area. How about generating the sentence? And this one linked very nicely to the NLP work there. Can the machine be taught to generate a caption that describes the object, scene, and relationship? So one of the very nice, well-known system called Show and Tell that was released by Google Group 2 years ago. Given this picture, run the deep neural net to understand the content, generate a sentence. Those are the example being generated by the machine. A group of people shopping at an outdoor market. One of my students looking at so-called attention model. So if we can locate the object that catches the viewer's attention, then the sentence generated will be more aligned with the attentive region in the pictures. And this is the metrics. I'm not going into the detail. As a faculty member, I tend to put a lot of numbers there in academia. So currently, the state of art is 31%. The Google show and tell that was 2 years ago was 24%. And you can see different sentences generated by different models tends to carry different information there. How does that compare to the human capability? There was an evaluation comparing machine-generated caption versus the human-generated caption. So there are 2 numbers here. One is the percentage of the caption generated by the machine. Was that better than or as good as the human-generated caption? So the one generated by the Google Show and Tell was 27%. So 73% of caption generated by the machine are still considered not as good as a human generated. So back, I heard there was a question about automatic news. I think there's still hope for the human operator to do much better than the machine here. Just plug in the link to the VidRover. One of my students started a company to look at the vertical domain, particularly in the news video domain. Can you search for the information, topic, people, and event in visual content? I think he's going to talk about this one later this afternoon. Very quickly, beyond describing what's in the picture, what about other abstract dimension? Aesthetic, which picture is beautiful? Which picture carries most compelling information? Which picture carries certain style of a photography? If you can do this, then there's a lot of opportunity to collect and select the trillions of photos taken every year by semi-professionals, including every one of us here, to the stock footage market, Shutterstock, maybe iStock, and others for portfolio, And we can empower the photographer to share the content in a much, much larger scale. So one of my colleagues started a company called Exxon Guru, is to fill the gap, is to select most beautiful picture and automate the process of tagging and describing. I think I'm running out of time here. But one of the examples I want to share is understanding the visual content and natural language content give you a lot of interesting dimensions to explore. Sometime in the social media, you have these three examples, and it's a very nice work by a group in Yahoo before. It looks at this picture here. It's very different from what we see here. It's an empty room. But the caption says, look at the crowds of the people they are to sell to. So you can see that the intended meaning and the content there is contradictory. So as Kathy and others mentioned, can we detect and discover this contradictory information and then raise that to the attention of the viewers so that we potentially could be deception, potentially could be sarcasm. And finally, in the age of the not completely trustable content here, I'm trying to use a different word, alternative description of different information. Is this true or fake? And we all know historically there are certain pictures being intentionally manipulated. And the person on the right-hand side was cropped out. And no offense to Wisconsin, even these cover pictures on the magazine, you can see the difference there. And I'm not sure you can see what's the difference before and after. And one of the person was specifically added to the picture to enhance the idea of a diversity. And if you suspect certain area probably doesn't fit everything, can we also find the provenance source? Where does that pixel, where does the object, where does that potentially fake content come from? If you have access to millions of pieces in a database, not only finding the match to buy a style or maybe fashion or clothes, can we find the true source of the information there? So I think there's a lot of opportunity for AI, for machine learning to help us to retain the integrity and trustworthiness of the information today. I think I will skip here. Thank you.
And Shifu, you can join us here as well if you'd like. So next we'll introduce Rahel Jerad, who is still on the faculty at NYU Center for Data Science. Are you still teaching down there? Still at NYU, and is now called Vice President of Data Science at Hearst, one of NYC Media Lab's other partners. And Rahel's going to tell you a little bit about how they're thinking about these questions at Hearst. And I was thinking about you when John was talking about the fact that we've got all this data architecture and all this plumbing in place now. What can we do with it? And I think of Hearst as being another company that's put a lot of effort into putting the pieces in place, the platform in place, to be able to ask some deeper questions, and that's what you'll tell us about. So, Rahel.
Thank you so much. So I've been at Hearst now for 2 years. I came from Wall Street, and really an honor to be at Bloomberg. I owned, had a Bloomberg for 10 years, and I miss it terribly. But it's been amazing to work, do the switch from finance to a media company. Just a plug for a meetup I run at called Economics and Big Data this Friday. If you're interested in AI, this is a leading researcher at Facebook talking about machine learning and image recognition at scale. So the group I run at Hearst composed of, I think of it as like four divisions. We do computer vision, we do NLP, we do traditional machine learning algorithms, and a focus on as well on video. So a little bit about Hearst. You know the magazines and properties that we edit and write, newspapers, entertainment syndication. So I work primarily with magazines, newspapers, business media, and broadcasting. We have a ton of image, text, and video that's beautiful data, not exhaust. And so the typical types of bread and butter of a machine learning group in a large media company focuses on, and this is sort of a picture of our data lake, our content, our ads, audience, on-site, clickstream, and off-site. So these are the typical types of things that we do, and that's our bread and butter. What I'll talk about is deep learning and apply to our media, which is super rich. So project quickly, I'm going to go through three demos. Project that I did with Justin and Amy and with Professor Cho at NYU. I mean, Professor Cho is an expert in deep learning and sequence-to-sequence modeling that's super important in machine translation. When I met him, he sort of just rearranged the molecules in my brain, and I just had a completely different view of machine learning and data science sort of after meeting him. So the project we worked on, and sort of deep learning has touched on a lot of areas. I won't go through it, but the two areas that deep learning touched on for us was vision and language. And so how can we take the text in our words, text in our articles, and translate them to images? So to give you a sense of the diversity of topics at Hearst, so these are some words from L and SFGate. And so these are the words that we're going to try to tie to images. And then these are some of our images from L. And then, image detection like 5 years ago, 6 years ago was human handcrafted edge detection. Now that's sort of replaced by end-to-end deep learning networks. So this is a slide from Jan LeClum, but actually the slide I think is from Matt Zeiler from Clarify. You can see the edges at the lower level and sort of the composed features in sort of middle and the last layer. So we took this, and our sort of application was this handbag detection. So what is that handbag that she's carrying? So this was like our Hello World. So we had four different brands, Celine, Chloe, Dolce, and Prada. I went and took photos from, walked down Madison Avenue, took some photos, got some e-commerce, and said, could we build a classifier that would detect the difference between them? And so that's our, on the end is the sort of how we view it in a two-dimensional way. So we tested, we build a training set and test set and evaluate how we did. So this was our first try, 80% accuracy. So you can see here it's saying that it's a Chloe, 98%, but this one it got wrong. And then we can upload an example, and then here is that image, and I would like to know what that is. Actually, you see that I'm manually cropping it, but actually we now can easily, we've automated all of this. But this was from last summer. And then you'll see that it's actually a Dolce bag. So image embeddings, these are ways that we could look at images and look at thousands of images altogether. So these are 500 representative images from our newspapers. You can see it's mostly sports, politicians, criminals, and places. Images from our magazines, they look a little bit different. So food, as you saw, vacation spots and sort of makeovers. So the project we worked on with Professor Cho was mapping words to images. So if I have the word cat, can I retrieve the cat without having thousands of examples of cats? So here's the demo. Let's see if it works. So I put in kittens. So we took 20,000 articles, looked at the words in the articles, and mapped them to their corresponding image vectors. And then we took new words, but we don't have an article called dog or garden, and it would then point to and retrieve images that were connected to those words. So now I'm using words that, and I haven't trained a Ford Mustang, or any of these, a Starbucks detector. It just learned those associations. So let's say I have an article. This was something that happened in SFGate, and I look at the image associated with it, and I said, maybe I can use a different image. So this was an article about, the south of France. Let me take all those words. What images would this algorithm suggest to it? And then we picked a very different domain, just took the title of it and sort of the similar type of retrieval. So that's sort of one of the things that we're doing. So it's text and mapping them to the image, and then we're looking at also the reverse. And then sort of very quickly, when we have lots of images, for example, in our print, and the domain is different, we try to discover what that is. We can actually look at that image and look at thousands of images and cluster them and look for, what are images that are close to each other. So when we want to discover our photographs and look at what we might hold in our and automatically tag or tag with labels of, that we are, more specific labels, we can sort of do that en masse. So this was a project we did earlier this year, and essentially we can tag this, these are 3,000 images. After tagging them, we can then take those tags and essentially spread them out to 10,000 images, so sort of scale all of this tagging. So that's a little bit about what we do at Hearst. I'll skip that. This is the types of tools that we use, TensorFlow, and the GPUs that I convinced our CTO to purchase last year. So on that note, these are some of the directions that we want to go into, but thank you.
Rahel. So we've got about 10 minutes before we take a coffee break, and we're going to take some Q&A from you. So I'm going to go ahead and open up to the floor, but I'm going to ask one quick question as the mic comes around to this gentleman here. In the first panel, there was this sort of, a little bit of foreboding, but also an optimism, but also just this idea of the being at the J-curve, being at the elbow. Do you see that from your perspective? Shiva, you've been working on these issues for, a couple of decades now. Do you feel like right now we're in a special moment, that we really are in an acceleration?
Yeah, I think so. I think it's really a very exciting time right now, not only from computer vision and machine learning being able to recognize the information, but also how do you integrate all this information from different modality, right? So image, video, text, social media, user behavior, and what is the intent, what's the effect, right? And even for the last topic I was talking about, the trustworthy news, right? Trustworthy source information. Single modality is not enough. Single source is not enough. Single time point is not enough. So I think in this data explosive era, it is challenging to call the information from everywhere, but it's also opportunity really to integrate and get more accurate, more reliable, more timely information.
Your presentation, I thought, with a couple of images, you showed everyone here, both the promise and also the peril of these technologies. Sure. I mean, how will we know what's real?
Sure. How do we know the real? And there's a program actually we participate in, sponsored by DARPA right now, is attacking this problem, right? Given an image, how do we know every pixel is trustworthy? And even every pixel is taken by the camera, how do you know the scene or the action is not staged, right? That's even worse. And so I think it's important capability we have to keep in mind what is the context of the decision making there. If the user is trying to understand the current situation, is a hurricane causing the damage in the downtown Manhattan? Is the enemy or is the opponent is taking certain action in certain field? I think collecting all the information provide timely summary and understanding to the decision maker is the key. Mm-hmm. I don't think machine can make the decision for everyone. And but how do we combine them is key, right?
Rahel, do you imagine these technologies just changing the way Hearst is organized in the future?
I think so. I think we've got such rich content. And, we've spent a lot of time creating a cloud environment and a secure environment for all the data. I move easily between what used to be called unstructured data and structured data. So I think these, like Hearst is investing in housing that data and making it actionable. So I think even like the provenance, like my first introduction to image was we had a bunch of print images. How were these used in magazines of our joint ventures? So I think it like underlies a lot of what we do.
And it's a J-curve at Fast Forward Labs?
I think so. I mean, A key enabler to data science and machine learning, those capabilities, is the availability of data in the first place, right? And I mean, if you just look at that, that's going up, right? So the key enabler, the key driver definitely is sort of like showing that trend. So I think that, you know, and unless we fail to make progress, we should basically track that. I think there's sort of one, there's several hurdles that we have to overcome, but one of them is like a lot of the techniques that we showed today that sort of power a lot of these very fun, exciting tools that really get us to dream about the future. They're powered by deep learning, and deep learning isn't the solution for everything. And something that I mentioned towards the end of my talk is, especially, it is very difficult to understand why deep learning made a certain prediction, and that can be a hurdle in actually implementing deep learning techniques in practice, because in regulated environments, you have to sometimes justify the decision that an algorithm makes. In the EU, there's sort of a new directive coming out that will basically limit the use of some of these sort of black box techniques. And so I think like either we have to redefine what we mean by an explanation, I could see lawyers doing that, or we have to sort of be a little more inventive when it comes to actually interpretability and explainability.
I'm going to take a question from the audience over there.
I didn't hear much about facial recognition. Can you talk about how far along we are to the point where somebody could scan this room and identify most of the people in it?
We're already there, right?
So I think, if I can take on that question.
Please.
Yeah, I think face recognition in the wild control condition is solved problem. But in a wild condition, for example, if a big crowd and you have thousands of people in the crowd, every face is only a tiny, a small number of pixels. And also in aging, right? People age over time. The picture you take as a young child, later on the person age to the senior, can you still recognize the same person? There's a Boston bombing. We know there's a picture of the suspect, but we cannot match them because it is under extremely poor lighting condition, different angle. That's still challenging. So it's still a very active research field in addressing all those adverse dimensions I mentioned earlier.
You think in terms of percentages of accuracy, right?
Sure, right.
So if we took a picture from where you're sitting right now, this room, how accurate do you think we could get? Hard to know.
Hard to know. And I think, for example, for celebrity pictures on the web, it's very high,
yeah.
Right? For everyone like me, a regular person, in a very small, tiny corner in a big crowd, that's still very low.
Okay. Right. Anybody else? Or another question from the audience? Dorian. Mike's coming.
We've seen a recent example with the Facebook murder video. We could also cite PewDiePie, that there's a lot of commercial impetus for machines to solve some of the problems that you, Professor Chang, alluded to, and also the other panelists. You think in percentages, you know, there's commercial impetus, so my question is really two. One, do you think how far are we from a tipping point where machines can solve the problem of, you know, spotting videos that we don't want to share or don't want to attach advertising to? Can you say anything about when machines are going to be really on the point of helping with that? And then two, do you think the commercial impetus is going to accelerate it?
So the first one, if I may answer
yep.
this question, and then other panelists can join here. Understanding the offensive content in image video, certain aspect I think is doable. For example, inappropriate kind of pornographic pictures and others, I think there has been a lot of product before to address that issue. But in terms of a violence or offense or murder, and those actually is still ongoing project, I don't think that's ready right now. And in terms of a commercial side, I think that's always a decision making by the business. How mature, how robust the content, the tool has to be ready before they can be deployed.
Well, how can you say when it might be above
50%? Before it can be applied? Yes. So the 40% number I was reporting on the event detection, that was on a well-defined data set, for example, human action. And there was an effort to collect 20 actions, for example, running, jumping, weightlifting, and maybe cliff diving. And over that 20 well-defined action, currently state of the art is 40%. in terms of detecting, localizing, and finding the precise time, not only say, okay, there's a video there. But going to the new area, say, if you go to collect a video, you don't know what the content would that be, right? The robot enters a new room. Robot enter a military field, is a certain action by the soldier or by other people, has never been defined, has never been given the training data. That's still an open question. I don't think that's 40% today. That's way, way lower.
It's also always going to be a cat-mouse game. It's always going to be a cat-mouse game. People who want to pose, they will try very hard to find ways to game those algorithms, right? And I think also, sort of two notes to also the earlier conversation. I think it is very tempting to design technological solutions, for example, for like a fake news problem or for like too much pornography on the internet. But I think, for example, fake news, I don't think it's primarily a sort of technological challenge, societal challenge that we are sort of facing. Right. And then I think the other thing is, like, while it's very tempting, I think we also really have to think very carefully about building those sort of algorithms that start policing our environment. Right. And who has the power over those algorithms. Right. And currently a lot of people are sort of asking for, can we just get that content off the Internet? I agree. That is not a video that I would ever like to see. And I don't want anyone to sort of like see that and be exposed to it. But at a larger question, like what are we doing? Who are we giving that power? Do we feel comfortable with that?
Rahel, on the question of where we're at in the commercialization of these technologies, how close are these things that you're working on right now? Are they implemented at Hearst? Are you getting close, or where's it at?
So I would say that the things that I showed you are not, but there are things that I haven't showed you that are in beta.
They're in
now.
The workflow.
Yes, and should connect our. The real world of images. So you showed that photograph, which was a digital image. But I could take a photograph of that handbag and then direct you to our site. So we're doing that in some of the other, not with handbags, but with other content. And that's almost, ready to go. And I would say just on the other question of, how close are we to getting all these things right? We're not Google, and yet we're able to build something that's very specific, and that is actually very accurate in a very specific domain. And so I think the sort of plethora of students and, the amazing amount of open source models that are available and startups, I think that, gives, much more. Like, I don't think it's the Googles of the world that are going to police all of this for us. And there's, plenty of space for people to build, kind of state-of-the-art bespoke models and put them into action.
One sentence. I think indeed the sort of biggest promise right now is to build very powerful solutions for very well-defined problems. Mm-hmm.
I'm going to take one last quick question from Lev Manovich, who probably has a few things to say on these subjects.
Hi, thank you. So for about 50 years, computer vision has been driven to a certain extent by a single paradigm, which is detection, right, localization. In the last 10 years, we have worked on recognizing photo techniques, aesthetics, sentiment, but I'm sure there are many other dimensions of visual communication images which computer vision scientists haven't even thought about yet. Do you have some ideas, right? Like what computer vision will be doing like in 5 or 10 years from now? Like what are we missing? Given that 70% of our brain is devoted to visual communication and the language is only 50,000 years old, my feeling is there's a lot we're not thinking about yet.
So how will your field evolve? What will your students be working on in 10 years, Shifu?
So we had a workshop last month in DC, actually talking about the next 10-year challenge for multimodal computer vision. One of the aspects is really, can machine or robot or agent develop the skill to work with human in a mutually understandable way, not only recognizing there's an apple there, what is a picture showing a certain sentiment, can machine understand what is my intent when I make certain gesture and when the group meeting here? So that kind of a full extension of emotion collaboration capability and social cue combine audio, speech, language, action to fully understand and collaborate and communicate is our holy grail in the next 10 years.
So is that going to have us bring in some of the social sciences, psychology,
yes,
economics?
Of course.
And that's where you come from, Rahel? Is it, you feel like those are things we'll be working on?
I think so, and I think, much more of the AR, VR type of, giving the the
3D basically.
Reader like an experience. Mm-hmm.
So in three dimensions we'll be working in.
I think so.
I think for me, what's exciting is certainly an image, but also sort of what you can do with text, right? And I mean, currently, for example, just separating like what is being said from how it's being said, like how it's being said currently, the solutions that we have are not particularly good. And it would be very exciting to sort of like see distinctions then, and particularly starting to track over time, like how it's changing how of how it's being said, right? To sort of really pick up on very sort of subtle signals that can power decisions.
We're going to stop there. It is time for a coffee break. I want to thank this panel very much.